Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of The Fear, written by Thomas Keneally and read by Peter Hosking. Be sure to visit our website on www.belinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording. The dedication reads, "To my mother, who was not still, but better." Chapter 1. Next door to us, crowded on the east and west by large houses, was the Mantles' narrow little brick place. It seemed to be subsiding crookedly into the earth like an ill-laid tombstone, and was a sunless warren, dim humidity in summer, dim moisture in winter. The laneway to its back door ran flush against our side wall, and beneath the Mantles' lounge room window a furze of moss grew a quarter of an inch thick on the mortar. Len Mantle and Hilda must have been in their early 30s and had two boys to boast of, though boast is in this case a cruel word, for the younger one was, physically at least, a slack-mouthed replica of his slack-mouthed father, and that was nothing to boast of, while the elder had some congenital disease of the nervous system which was, cell by cell, turning his muscles to jelly and making him walk on the balls of his feet, in what many people who did not know believed to be an insane parody of elegance. Our old home, my parents and mine, had been no more than 400 miles northwards, and not even in another state. Still, our migration plunged me into shock. The heat was duller. The air was full of sweat. By night I choked with asthma. By day I haunted the yard, not believing that from it you couldn't sight a brown elbow of river. Guernseys cropping an emerald floodplain. The smoke-blue tangle of New England hills. My eyes constantly returned to a galvanised iron fence, and beyond it the brick butt ends of shop residences. Inevitably, Hilda saw me, and judging me merely lonely, told my mother to send me in to meet the boys. It wasn't long before I essayed that fungoid lane which led towards the squabbling noise of the Mantles at play with each other in their overgrown backyard. As Len Mantle was to say, a man with a cause has no time to muck about with lawnmowers. They sat on flattened grass beneath an old peach tree, arguing over a bow made out of a peach sapling by their almighty father. Their small angry heads nodded polemically. Their hair was straight, fine Asiatic hair, as if their grandmother had known a Chinaman. And as they spoke, it flopped over their foreheads in wads. There was an Asiatic smoothness and roundness about their faces, and the corners of their eyes were Asiatically taut. No direct acknowledgement of my existence in their own backyard was made, but all the heat went out of their squabble. They began to perform their argument, and I, knowing my place, stood by, showing polite interest as it developed. "You let the bloody string go loose," the younger one hissed, pausing for me to marvel at the adjective. "Comrade Lennon told you not to. He told you how to keep it tight. He told you you could use it even. But off he goes to work and you spoil it on me. Now we have to wait for Comrade Lennon to make us another one, and he might be too busy to make it for years. Comrade, I could kick your guts in." The elder brother Joe was sitting with his long legs and abnormally arched feet tucked under him. For a while he kept silence, for he understood that Lenny, the other one, was just a young buck rattling his spears. What he didn't understand, what I didn't know, was that he was, in strict truth, sitting on death, that the enemy of his blood and his gens was, at that moment, under the peach tree, seducing his nerves, lulling his muscles to reflexless blubber. He leant across towards Lenny, picked up the bow and flexed it. Knobbly elbows splayed out from his sides, for the enemy was in his arms as well. "Who said you owned it?" he asked. "I remember the day he made this, he made it for me. I didn't ever say you could use it." Lenny leant forward and roared in his brother's face. "You stinking big liar, Joseph. I helped the comrade make this bloody bow on the day you had the pains. He made it for me. Why would he make it for a bloke who can't even walk proper?" Joseph squinted savagely at the insult, rolled it over on his tongue, spat it out onto the grass. Lenny was wise enough to sit back, waiting for the argument to sprout a new limb. "The time he made another bow and arrow," Joseph said at length, "he let me cut it off a tree with his own knife." This was answer complete. This was fulfilment. To cut a bough with a comrade's own knife. "I was too small to cut it then. That's the only reason. He felt my muscles and said I was a real son to have. He told me he always wants me to cut his wood, right until I die." Joseph had the calm certitude of mountains and icebergs. His anger was a queer, wise anger that gave what he said neither heat nor eloquence, but the sting of truth. "He wouldn't say that. You're 6. Who'd talk to a 6-year-old as if he was important? I can tell you, Lenny, I'm as good as a grown-up to the comrade. You're a baby of a 6-year-old. Grown-ups tell babies anything. They even tell them Santa Claus." Perhaps Lenny did lose his self-control there. He yelled and ground his teeth and hurled himself on his brother. Nature had provided for an even fight. Lenny's short, strong limbs tangling with Joseph's weak, long ones. The two rolled on the crushed yellow grass in what was more likely brotherly love than anger. As they grunted at my feet and Lenny spat maniac hate through clenched teeth, I saw that I had the balance of power and decided to use it in a statesmanlike manner. To win Lenny, down I dropped on that bundle of melodramatically writhing limbs, that vortex of hisses and threats. Joseph's right arm had been flung wide of the fight and lay along the grass abnormally long like a pallid eel. On this I knelt. Joseph screamed and Lenny, about to deal some death blow or other, became immediately still and stared at me. "Don't touch my brother," he growled. Not forcefully enough to warrant hostilities, though, since I was taller than he was. He rose from where he had been sitting on Joseph's diaphragm. "Don't be so cruel." I progressed on my knees off Joseph's arm, embarrassed at the fierce little face glaring at me over Joseph, flat on the ground, groaning detachedly. "A comrade will belt the tripes out of you for being cruel to Joseph." The victim raised himself on his elbows and nodded. "Comrade Lennon, about whose exact nature I was still guessing, was something worth placating," said the nod. "My brother Joseph," Lenny went on with pride, "is going to be a cripple. His muscles will squeeze up and then he's going to die." I stared at Joseph's legs, looking for some horrific sign on their lengthy whiteness. "It won't hurt," Joseph explained. His face was gratified. His little brother had recognised him as a child of election. "Are you really going to die?" I asked him. "Too right," he said. "What's your name?" After a while, there was another brawl and I was allowed to join in, fighting at will on both sides. Sunlight had left the yard and the flaccid grass was cold. Wrestling had overheated me, given me croup, making my under jaw itch in that unscratchable, penetrating way that croup does. We were all standing around talking limply when Hilda appeared in the back door, her hair newly combed and her face done up. Her fragrance carried as far as the peach tree. "Comrade Lennon's train just passed," she called. It was rarely that she could predict the comrade's coming. Rarely, and by a hard road, for only after a furniture-breaking brawl, a bout of repentance, a promise of eternal domesticity by the comrade, could his wife be sure for a day or two of when she would see him and in what state. Of course, that afternoon I didn't know all this. Lenny and Joseph appeared to me to be people established in their neighbourhood. Out of the peach tree and the rank backyard, out of the to and fro of trains, the to and fro of Comrade Lennon, they seemed to have compounded for themselves a ritual day. They herded the hours along under firm control. They waved at the trains as if every man and woman on board were their godparents. They didn't blush when the best they earned from any carriage in a long series of dusk electrics was a few half-turned blank faces. They were happy. Comrade Lennon was on his way home to them. Out of the last of many vivid knots of people stamping down the street away from the station, he came in a tweedy old sports coat, grey trousers and boots. In his breast pocket he wore an enviable blood-red handkerchief, embroidered with a white hammer and sickle. He was clearly a relative of theirs. I was still uncertain whether he was their father or not. Lenny ran to him. Joseph stalked up to him on the balls of those extraordinary feet. As they approached him, he stood still and clenched his fist towards the sky, while a passing typist ducked below the indiscriminate gesture and hurried away. "Hail, comrades!" he called to the boys. "Hail, comrade!" they sang. "Did you have any fights today, comrades?" he asked, as if training them in the ways of peace were his prime work. "No fear," said Lenny. "Good," said Comrade Lennon. As he came through the gateway, I jumped aside, half hoping he hadn't even seen me. "And did you behave yourself for the mother of the people?" "I did, not Joseph." By now, we were trailing the great man down his dim laneway. He reached his hand out onto Lenny's straight hair and lovingly tousled it. "You're a character, comrade. You're a heck of a character." We walked forward into sunlight. Comrade Lennon met Hilda with suspect ardour. I wondered if he came home daily, for there was something forced and dishonest in their embrace. Something feigned, like the feigned anger that had flung the boys against each other earlier that afternoon. I can remember now that probably a dozen kitchen windows in flats and cottages looked down on the Mantles backyard. Flats and cottages where rumours of the comrades' drinking, violence, shiftlessness were harboured. Hilda was a proud girl. Even now she looked up at him and murmured, "You've been having some." "Only a nip," he grunted, and they went inside. "Why does he wear a red handkerchief?" I asked the boys. "That's his colour," said Lenny. "It's the colour of the Soviet flag." "The people's flag is deepest red," Joseph explained. "Didn't you know that?" "Yes," I lied. "It's bathed in the blood of the workers." "Is his handkerchief bathed in their blood?" "Yes," Lenny whispered. "When did he bathe it in their blood?" "After they'd been shot in the back by someone. The catalysts." Joseph was bland in his knowledge of whence the workers' blood flowed. "Why did they shoot them?" "They were scared of them." "Is Comrade Lennon a worker?" "He's one of the leaders of the workers." "Then why didn't they shoot him?" "He ran away?" Lenny suggested. Joseph sneered at this. "He didn't run away. They thought he was dead, but he wasn't. There was a soldier like that at the pictures." "Soldier like what?" Comrade Lennon had come into the yard in his slippers. He was in his shirt sleeves, the coat and the bloody handkerchief being away somewhere deep in the Mantle house. I could imagine some sort of reliquary with candles flanking it for that piece of linen which had been dipped in precious blood. "You got a new mate," he observed. His eyes flapped across my face with gross indifference. There was something about me which made me unfit to pluck a bow, yell or spit, roll and wrestle with his comrades. I was a bit livid and narrow-chested, I admitted to myself, from pneumonia the previous November. "What's your name, youngster?"
"Daniel Jordan."
"Well, Daniel Jordan," he said, slicing my name up with the thin edge of his tongue. "You'd better go home. I'm taking the boys for a walk. You can come back tomorrow."
"Yes."
"I'll be seeing you. Joseph? Lenny?" They followed him into a kitchen redolent of lamb chop fat. Now I had the whole yard, but mere possession was meaningless without them. Dusk dropped from the peach tree. The lane lay before me like a catacomb. Running its length, I was standing on our veranda in time to see the comrade usher his sons into the street and take them uphill. Lenny yabbered at his side. Joseph stalked forward as if the ground was strewn with nettles. They reached a point at last where trees and railway embankment, the coming night and steam from a reined-in engine all blended into utter shadow. Chapter 2. Then Singapore fell. The very sucklings quaked for its fall. A cabinet minister whispered in committee that one armoured division could take Australia. People taped their windows, making them shatterproof, prophesying that the only human factor that could save us was America. Women sought moral guidance on the question of suicide or dishonour. Troops trained with sticks and guarded beachheads with axes. Bombs homed down on London and corpses were dug out each morning, that was true. Yet no country was ever so naked before invasion.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.